written after I was shot. Darling Nancy, I was shot leading a rush up Moore Street and took refuge in a doorway. While I was there, I heard the men pointing out where I was and made a bolt for the laneway I am in now. I got more than one bullet, I think. Tons and tons of love, dearie, to you and the boys, and to Nell and Anna. It was a good fight, anyhow. Please deliver this to Nanny O'Rahilly, 40 Herbert Park, Dublin. Goodbye, darling.
As a youngster growing up, there was something about the house. I can't really describe it as such, but it was something historical that I felt. There was something that I felt was unusual. But I only got to know about it, as I say, many years later. We used to play in the drawing room, and I was a devil for music, and I started playing the piano. And immediately my uncle came in and just slammed the piano down and said, "You don't play that," and locked the with a key. I said, "What is that all about?" So then the history came that my grandmother used to play the piano all the time. She was a wonderful pianist. But after her husband was killed in the action on the Moore Street battlefield site, she put the lid down the piano and never played again.
He was from County Kerry. He's born in Ballylongford in 1875, but he went off to America as a young man. Maybe a bit of adventure attracted him over there. He stayed for about 10 years in the United States, and he married a woman called Nancy Brown.
The O'Rahilly called himself the O'Rahilly. If you go to Connemara or anywhere in Irish in the Great, the was a title of the eldest man in the family, which he was, the only son, you see. And in Ballylongford, this was accepted.
When the Volunteers were founded in 1913, O'Rahilly was at the forefront. And when MacNeill decided to cancel the Irish Volunteers' role in the uprising, he asked O'Rahilly to drive around Ireland, stopping the uprising.
Garrett Fitzgerald's son handed him in Herbert Park the order to go fully armed in the car, and he was sitting in the back trying to hold the arms down in case there was a barricade, and his sister drove the car into Liberty Hall.
By Friday of Easter week, things were looking very bad in the post office, and here's where O'Rahilly really comes into his own, because he went to Pierce and he said, "If I can get a group of men, we'll charge down Moore Street and break our way through the British lines and make our way to Williams and Woods, a very well-known jam factory." And O'Rahilly, of course, was approached by Desmond Fitzgerald, one of his best friends. And Fitzgerald said to him, "Michael, best of luck, I'll see you later." And he says, "Desmond, I'll never see you again. You were a good friend." And he shook his hands very stoically. And he marched his men out the side door of the post office, and he turned onto Moore Street, and they broke through their own barricade that they had built earlier on in the week. And he says, "Let's charge." And they charged into the jaws of death. Nearly half of the guys who were in that run were either wounded or killed. O'Rahilly slumped into a doorway, and he wrote a little note to his wife to tell her what had happened. And of course, we hang on to that one line: "It was a good fight anyhow," because you don't have to be the winner to be the victor. And I think we know that as Irish people. I think O'Rahilly is very well remembered. I know certainly when I talk about him on my walking tour, I'm always happy to see that many people are familiar with the story, especially Irish people. I would say if O'Rahilly had lived, that the British would have executed him in 1916. That's how important a character I think he is.
And she got completely involved. And after the Rising, she was in the White Cross, which was very, very important because it provided support for people who were in the Rising or related to it, and indeed who were in the War of Independence. So it was a very important organization. She was also a vice president of Cumann na mBan. So she had completely taken on the Irish aspect. And the women of that time, of course, were tremendous. They were very active and very fearless.
One particularly interesting part of the story of Herbert Park is the 1907 Irish International Exhibition, which happened in this very space. And when you walk around the park today, you really wouldn't have a sense of it, but almost 3 million people, anything between 2.5 and 3 million people, came through Herbert Park to see that incredible exhibition. It was a great show of Irish commercial life and Irish commercial activity. It's palatial, what was built. The exhibition halls, the performance spaces, all of that now gone. All that remains really is a bandstand and a lake, but they built this, if you will, for a great display of Irish commercial activity. But on land that was utilised as part of the exhibition, they construct these three beautiful Edwardian villa homes. And they're kind of in keeping with the spirit of the exhibition in that they're, you know, they're made of Irish materials. They highlight the best of the day in terms of Irish commercial life. But they're a legacy in one way of the 1907 exhibition.
And an awful lot of the leaders lived in this area. Pierce lived on Marlborough Road, and De Valera lived on Moorhampton Terrace, and McNeil was on Herbert Park. So quite a smattering of them, all in the same area, probably meeting each other on the street all the time and exchanging revolutionary tactics.
Both gun runnings in Howth and Kilcool were planned in the house. Bulmer Hobson attended meetings in the house. Arthur Griffith. Roger Casement, who was lying low up in Owen McNeil's house up the road, he came down. Three Irish presidents turned up for meetings and walked through the door of Herbert Park. Douglas Hyde, De Valera, and Sean T. O'Kelly. All the signatories, and I mean all of the Irish proclamation signatories, attended meetings in the house. They were all there. They were all in that house planning.
I think it's unfortunate people talk about 40 Herbert Park in the context of the O'Rahilly's life alone, and, you know, as if the story of this house ends with that famous note that he writes to Nancy and addressed to 40 Herbert Park. In the aftermath of that, the house assumes a very interesting life in the years of the Irish Revolution. The decision to burn the Custom House in 1921 was taken at a meeting around the table in 40 Herbert Park. And when you look at who was there, Oscar Traynor, Cathal Brua, Michael Collins, Eamon de Valera, I mean, they're all at this meeting in 40 Herbert Park where they discuss the need for a spectacular, so to speak. De Valera was the president of the Republic. He'd just been on a speaking tour of America. And Dev was very conscious of how the revolution was playing out in the global press. You know, he believed that this was being reported across the world as a murder gang, that the, you know, the IRA were shooting policemen in their ones and twos down country laneways. He felt to turn the narrative, they needed a great spectacular. And the spectacular he argued for at the table in 40 Herbert Park was the burning of the Custom House. So that's the last great event of the War of Independence in Dublin. And the decision to do that was taken around the table of 40 Herbert Park.
I was furious. I was sick. How they could treat a man that gave his life for this republic like this.
An application was put in under fast track planning, strategic housing development, which effectively allows you leapfrog public participation because you go directly to Bord Pleanála. And the only recourse, if you don't agree with the Bord Pleanála decision, then is to go to court under a judicial review. And in this case, not alone were the public denied access to the planning process because it was fast-track planning. In this case, we were denied an opportunity to go to court because the house was demolished before the time was up.
I went down and I put in a complaint that it was an illegal demolition and that not one brick or block was to be removed from that site. I want this house to be rebuilt brick by brick. That's what I want, just like what had happened to the Archer's garage many years ago.
From a point of view of justice, from a point of view of the integrity of the planning process, that house should be rebuilt so that the wrongdoing can't be seen to be okay. I mean, for members of the O'Rahilly family to have witnessed the destruction of the family home must have been incredibly traumatic. Where the O'Rahilly lived was demolished at dawn, and where he died is to be demolished under a developer-led plan. There's something wrong in relation to that. Today we launched a plan that will preserve and protect the Moore Street area, which has been described by the National Museum of Ireland as the most important historic site in modern Irish history. There's a developer-led proposal to develop Moore Street based on commercial principles, and our position is that we must have a conservation approach to the development of this area given its historic connection to 1916. Most campaigns are against the state. We're asking for state intervention. The state have a direct role in this in that they are the owners of property, and of course within the boundaries of the site is the National Monument. So at the stroke of a pen, the minister can turn down the present Hammerson proposal, become proactive in seeing a plan that everybody can support be put in place.
In the course of being in Moore Street, they had managed to take over this entire terrace. They had trained in tunnelling through walls and in tunnelling through buildings. So that's what they did down from number 10 until they got to 16, where the leaders created a sort of an encampment for themselves. After they had all these negotiations with Elizabeth Farrell walking out of the house and up the street on her own, facing into a battery of guns, it was extraordinary. And she had to go up and down several times before everything was settled and Pierce did the surrender. It was all very dramatic. And it deserves a decent museum type, a reviving, and something which gives an idea of what it was like.
I think it's significant that for as many years back as I can remember now, going back to the 90th anniversary of the Rising and even earlier than that, there's been this constant debate over the future of Moore Street. It's gone in and out of the various courts, forward and back. And you know, on some level, people that are interested in that debate should look at what happened at 40 Herbert Park, because it shows how quickly that debate can be stopped. As far as I'm concerned, 40 Herbert Park was an ongoing debate. So, I mean, when things are destroyed in this city, generally speaking, they've been destroyed at 6:30 in the morning and debates are cut short. And I think there's a warning cry in 40 Herbert Park for heritage in the city.
I think that the government, they seem to be adamant to raise our past history, and I'm not going to stand for it.
We have to be very careful that we don't run out of the attractive things that bring people to Ireland in the first place. People come for the history, the literature, the music, and the people. They don't come because we have 400 hotels.
Well, of 30 locations directly linked to the Rising in Dublin City, 19 have been demolished. Those that are left, some are unrecognisable in relation to how they appeared during the course of the Rising. You can read from the pages of a book and learn about history, or you can inhabit history. You can stand in the very footsteps of the people who made history. And that's what's at stake. No one generation has a right to destroy a city. A city should be kept preserved and protected for future generations. That should be our role.